interested in stories that explore what I think of in my head as a hyper unreality. So something, or like taking reality to the point where it no longer makes sense, so everything seems surreal, no matter how real it may be. And I'm especially interested in that with Black people.
Again, my name is Lendl. Trying to see where to start. So I'm originally from Baltimore, like Rashid. And I think, like, I guess my entryway into filmmaking was in visual arts. So I was about grade school. I used to draw and paint and stuff like that. And then I found video toward the end of my high school ages. And it sort of just grabbed me immediately. It was something that felt second nature to me. And I guess one thing I didn't really realize at that age is that filmmaking was attainable. Like, it was something that was actually an art. I always thought it was like something you made in the industry. It was cranked out and you had it. It wasn't until high school I realized, like, oh, I can make this into art. This is something that I've always been doing. And so now, what I'm really interested in, what I've always been interested in, I guess, as my work has a social justice underpinning, whether if it's advocacy for youth in public schools or whether it's individuals who are fighting for adequate, like, wages and stuff like that. But I think there's other ways of showing that humanity just through storytelling. So the most recent project that you're about to see a clip from is about my family, actually, and happened very serendipitously. And upon discovering my great-grandmother was gravely ill, I had a conversation with her that sort of evolved into something else more. And, but I guess you guys can watch that. And this conversation, just to preface, is a conversation between my sister and I, and then my mom pops on the phone. So, there we go.
Hold on, let me put mommy on the phone.
Alright, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
First point, being the area where everyone settled, eventually they migrated to other areas, some in Baltimore County, some in Baltimore City, and then also transportation, which is where I grew up.
He was my boyfriend in school. Then he went in service and he came home. And so then when I had got married, we were separated. And he was married and separated. And anyway, we would go to the racetrack and everything together. She would get upset and then put me out. Because in them times, a lot of big time. She said, he's a married man, he's a married man. But that was the best guy I know. And one night I decided I was going to Adam's bar. And George was sitting up there on that bar. And he said, you know, this ain't no place to find a husband. The next time I kept you in this posture, he said, I'm with your ass all the way down Oak Street. And I never did go there no more looking for no man. I like going to the city. that's what I went to Atlantic City with this guy that I met down on Baltimore Street. He looked like hat, you know. I had mom's hat. He got ready to go to bed in the gym. So kill him. And the captain's in the room. So he gonna kick the cat. When he kicked the cat, the cat went out of his ass and quite tore his face up and stressed him all over me. Thank him. I bet he came out of that room and packed his clothes so fast and hopped in the taxi and went from that out. He heard from him no more. I'm a cat. And I've been speaking. That was my hair, not real. And that was proof. Dreams were gone. That was the first one I went on. She went on the second one. So in 1969 is when we went to Jamaica. That's a dream during how to swim. She turned on that ship. You don't know about no swimming.
Because I used to lie a lot, and my mom then there's like one clip in the middle of it that's this very short video clip. And I just became obsessed then in high school with this idea of photography being an entry into film, and really just seeing them both as this way to tell stories when I didn't want to write it down first. So, yeah.
And how about now? Are there any other art forms that you dabble in?
Still tough to articulate, but there's like so much glue, I think, between some of the visual arts, some of the like sort of rhythmic arts. Like, I'm not sure how to explain it, but I feel like, and this may be a lie I tell myself, so I don't commit to anything, but that, like, sort of the more art forms you can kind of practice, the more things you can kind of know about other stuff, and always finds a way to incorporate itself into what you make. So, I mean, I play with music, I don't really make music, but I feel around with it, and DJ with it on the side, and the photo, I think, is pretty regular. It's as regular as this video.
Does Instagram count?
Yes.
I put a lot into my Instagram. My feed is lit. So I, you know, visual work. So I try to incorporate my films in a three-dimensional space, so installation work, and I think that counts. So creating spaces that, you know, speak to the narrative of my film. So incorporating this deeper dialogue with my audiences is something I'm passionate about. But
you don't have to answer it, but do you dabble in any other forms?
I mean, I think we all do to a certain degree inherently because it's where we are as in like country and this economy and stuff like that. So either out of necessity or out of just like pleasure, I think we sort of all do in some way right now. So
I feel like the tools too like encourage you to go with that. You know what I mean? Like I think we all shoot photos and we all do videos. We have photo cameras that also shoot video. You know what I mean? Like, or I, like a lot of, you know, folks that will design other things. I feel like because composition becomes part of the practice, you know, learning sort of other compositional rules, learning about color kind of leads you down other art forms, I think.
Right. Like being a director or making films, there's so much in one piece, like there's so much in one film, like you're always thinking about even fashion, you're thinking about color, you're thinking about design, you're thinking about frame, and all that kind of stuff, sound, everything.
Yeah, I think that's what makes me interested. Like some of the directors I'm fascinated with, they also have the practices that also find their ways into their work, you know? Like, some directors are really into music, and you find how they tend to put images together is really rhythmic, or some more art directors are in the production design or art design, art direction, and you start to see that come out as well,
Riffing off the other directors, how do you all catalog your inspiration? So I imagine you're finding it all the time, and how are you organizing it for yourself? Or the public?
I can talk about this one. If you know me, you know I collect a lot of images all the time. Like I have one giant Tumblr where I just collect a bunch of stuff and I don't like really side Tumblr rooms. If I find something interesting, I tend to file it away. And it's this really weird like Dropbox system that I can call stuff at any time for any like pull images and stuff like that. But I tend to like the demos. So I carry a hard drive. I'm trying to be like Questlove there, so Questlove carries like 50 hard drives, and they all have like whole episodes of Soul Train. Like, I'm trying to get to that level, but it's just all like, you know, like, I don't know, Barry Jenkins, like, all his, you know, scripters, something, I don't know. But I tend to carry a hard drive around with me everywhere as well that has like a collection of, like, a collection of movies, a collection of photos, a collection of just like random inspiration.
I'm pretty analog. I like to hold in touch, and so I have a huge bulletin board with images that I pull, because I feel like after a while everything's so digital, it all blends into the same. I lose files. I'm a Pisces, so I'm very disorganized, so everything is all over my space, my studio. So I tend to, whenever I see something, I try to get a tangible application, because it speaks to me more. So yeah, there's no real category or anything. It's kind of all over the place.
I think for me, like, it's project-based, so like if I'm working on a particular project, my brain's in a certain space, so I look up items based upon the project almost. At least that's what's been happening most recently. Of course, when you're like on the internet all the time, there's always this like bank of just like a billion images and something may attract you. But for the most part, I think about images in that when I make like little folders for references, or it might be films that I might have for that moment that I might reference. But,
yeah, I just take a lot of screen caps of movies that I'm watching, so it makes it kind of annoying to watch movies with me because I pause it like every 10 minutes and I'm like, hold on a second, I have to take this, and I have to like put it into this folder for this movie. So that's, I do that all the time.
Yeah. I want to come back to some of your practice, but I would like to ask you all, how does Philadelphia, since this is sponsored part by the Philadelphia Film Office, how does Philadelphia factor into your work? And I think all of you received your training here, and to some extent. So could you talk about Philadelphia factoring into your work, and your just your opinion, I guess, of where you and your work fit into the filmmaking community?
Freelance like Rashid, like a brand agency and event type stuff. That's how it pays the bills. And then that's how it sort of came about. And Philly's one of these beautiful cities where if you know one person, you know like 30 people. So I don't know. It's been the great thing about Philly, there's this this sort of family that exists here. And you might not know it when you first get here, but like people will find you. And that's the beautiful thing about it. I think that's the one thing that's, and even amongst this table, and that's what's happened. And I think that family has been very important, especially recently, in trying to find spaces where you identify with yourself in a city that is changing rapidly. So,
all right, cool. So I moved to Philly in 2003 to go to school, and Temple was one of two schools that I chose, and I chose Temple and Philly, one exact frontier. And then during the time, like, that's when Philly music was popping. Like Joe Scott, the Roots, you know, like D'Angelo was recording stuff here, like all the people that were in love with. So coming to Philly was, Philly to me was this like musical playground, this musical like haven that I could go and you know hang out with my Questloves, like duffel bag or something like that. And so a lot of my time in Philly was, well, a lot of my time in Philly was oriented around music stuff. So a lot of the work that I ended up making over time became a lot about like Philly music scene and of the Philly music scene. And Philly, I think, again, it's one of those things like Philly and Detroit are two cities music that I talk about for hours because it's such a fascinating history here. But Philly is also like this, you know, I think, so my style has been affected a lot by Philly because there's a lot of shooting like the beauty and the hideous necessarily, you know? You're shooting against a relatively depressed looking city and you're, you know, my eyes now kind of trained to look for interesting and sort of beautiful stuff. And, you know, this kind of like, sometimes gray, abysmal feeling, not to talk trash about Philly, but from Baltimore, you know, come on. but you know, but Philly, I mean, Philly is not like always a, like a, an immediately obvious and inspiring place to look at, right? And so I think being here and learning how to find beauty visually in places has been really, really helpful, and it's been a really huge part of my work. A lot of my eye goes to what's up whenever it's in the environment. But then Philly also, culturally, musically, is just like, it's rich, and you have to kind of like, you can stand around and find it, or you can kind of ask to come to the table, or come to the table with something, and people tend to let you into those spaces. But I think all of those things have influenced how I make work, like a lot of the work. I tend to think about community when I make work, or I tend to think about, you know, whatever richness people are coming from making work, and I don't know if I would think about things in that way if not living in Philly and making work in Philly for so long.
Philly has, I love Philly. It was my ticket out of suburbia. I grew up in Maryland, and I had to get out, and Philly was my escape. And like Rashid, the roots were a huge inspiration. The roots can make it, they can make it. So I came into my own, I believe. I went to Temple undergrad, and I also just became, developed my artistic sense, just being independent, really exploring the city. And my first film was on sneaker culture. And so that was my first kind of exploration of this subculture. And that's the thing about Philly, it's so rich in these subcultures. And so there's so much to explore. And I think that really contributed to my fascination of documenting certain communities as well. So, you know, Philly, and then I moved to New York for grad school. I went to the School of Visual Arts, and, you know, that hustle, and it's just in a different vibe, and I knew that this would be a great place for me to cultivate more, so I came back. It's like, you know, it sucks you in, and you can't get out, but it's contributed a lot to my artistic development, for sure.
It is quite the vortex.
Yeah.
I keep trying with it. I did also want to ask you, since we promised in the description the title of this panel, what does blackness mean to you, and how does it impact your work and priorities?
Darkness.
I mean, I think the term is within the eye of the beholder sort of situation. You know, I think these terms can get sort of arbitrary, but also empowering at the same time. It's like, for instance, like saying something is green, how that word could be saying, oh, this is, you know, this is coming from the earth, but someone could take that same word and it could be three other different things in context of that, but it's not really like organic or whatever you want to, like, so that's what we're dealing with, I think, at this point, when we're like blackness, especially in a year when you have the Oscars and what they do, which is beautiful, but what happens after that? And so I think with that said, for me, blackness is sort of, I think it's proprietary to, you know, to each person. And I think for me, and especially my process, is like when I try to make what you guys saw, I was thinking about like hanging around my great grandmother and Saturday morning seeing cartoons and what it was like to have her iced tea. And so how do you encapsulate those moments, make people feel that without having to say that and like beat people over the head with it? Like how do you just flow and it just feels seamless? So that's what I think it is for me, because I think a lot of black stuff is about rhythm, and obviously that music played a huge part with yourself, so.
I agree. The nuances of blackness, just, you know, like Lendl said, the, you know, the gestures and the culture, and what does that look like, and how can you paint that in diverse ways that you're not used to seeing, and what does that culture feel and look, you know? So all the layers and the complexity of the culture and how to document it in a very observational form. I think that's fascinating.
Yeah. To me, blackness is always like some type of like richness, you know what I mean? Or sometimes some type of like code. You know, like I listen to Ultra Light Beam. You guys know this Ultra Light Beam by Kanye West. Like, that's black as shit to me. You know, like, I mean, it's and it's a song, it doesn't have a color, you know. But I mean, it's like the richness and the experiences that we've had and that we come here with, you know what I mean? That we tend to infuse in the artwork that we make. That sometimes it's a conversation with the person engaging it, sometimes it's a critique, sometimes it's just a reference to something that, you know, like, you know, like, you know, that's like, you know, that's a reference to something that we're super familiar with. Come to America. Taste the soup. But like for saying that, like probably argue, right? Somebody on this side. Like, you know, that's what to me, I can't explain it better than that. But when I think about blackness, I think about those little cues that, you know, you get, you know, that have been spread either from person to person or generationally or through media or through, you know, however the culture spreads.
I feel like at least insofar as it pertains to the work that I make, blackness is whatever I make. So I feel like I'm black, and therefore this is the story that I'm going to tell. And thus, that is a black story. That's just how I view it, and I love that. And it's really important to me in making sure that I'm creating stories that aren't concerned with or that don't have to be, aren't forced to reckon with, like, this, honestly, system of systemic oppression, and aren't always having to question their blackness in relation to whiteness. So that, for me, is another big part of blackness. Like, I feel like, at least, I mean, I know a lot of black people, I am black as well, and I feel like a lot of us don't go around saying, waking up in the morning like, I am black. I am not white, and what does that mean to it? Like, you know, it's just like I wake up and I am Tayarisha, and that feels great, and I love being black. And so I want to create characters who also have the freedom to wake up and say, I am X, I am so and so, I am who I am, and thus I'm black because I'm black.
It's great to hear you say that, and I want to open it up to the audience very shortly. But the other thing that I was thinking of, and this isn't really a question as much as posing a thought. I've been hanging out with folks who are thinking a lot about the black mundane. And I know we talk about black joy a lot, and clearly we're also being pounded over the head with lots of black death and other kinds of tragedy. But you know, the really beautiful thing about Atlanta or Insecure is that it's quite mundane. And I think we don't really get to deal with the mundane because we're always talking about blackness as opposed to whiteness, which, you know, is rife for tragedy. So someone outside, when we were talking about Black History Month, was like, we should be talking about black futures. And I think the ultimate goal that I've heard from some Afrofuturists is not to talk about blackness. You wouldn't have to talk about it because you would be humans. So I'd just be curious if you're thinking about that at all. And then just to sort of add to that, Tayarisha, you just answered this, but something we're always wrestling with BlackStar as a festival or as a project is what makes a black film. So, statements. And then we'll all come to you guys.
Negro is a black film. No, wait a second. In terms of, I guess, the black mundane, I'm so happy that we're kind of having this moment, and I hope this moment keeps going, of looking at, you know, Atlanta to me has been one of the best shows that I've watched for a long time, because it's been super absurdist. It never had, like, it's been super absurdist, super left. It never had, like, a really preachy moment or a teachable moment or a moment like that. You just kind of, like, you have these flawed characters that are living their life. Sometimes they do really funny stuff. Sometimes they get into situations that are messed up, but it's not this. It's like more of a meditational life that feels really specific, more than like folks trying to make something super, you know, encapsulating of the black experience in every way. You know what I mean? They even kind of make fun of that, which I appreciate. And I guess in my own work, you know, I'm always trying to think about that, right? Like I like having the canvas of being a black person and experiencing. experiences that we've had to inform how I look at certain things, and also use that hopefully as a way to sort of to try to look at the world in a way that, you know, some of my more caucasoidal counterparts, I just want to see if I can get a little stand in my microphone. No, you know what I mean? Like, Raul, like, where she may not have the same opportunity to look at, right? Because I've been forced to examine my experience, I've been forced to sort of examine my place in the world, I've been forced to examine the type of art that I want to make and the impact that I want to make, and I've thought about it over and over and over and exhausted it in so many conversations to the point where it's kind of an inherent part, that texture is kind of an inherent part of what tends to come out, and I hope, you know, I hope more folks can make more stuff that does examine what we've been calling black regularness. You know what I mean? Just, I mean, there's so much stuff to explore in just regular ass life that, you know, you experience it as a person of color, as a black person, as a woman, as a whatever it is, you walk around the sort of claiming it and being it. But that's sort of like part, that's sort of like a spoken part of the experience, and then, all right, cool, let's get to what life is all about. I don't know if I answered the question at all.
Also just, yeah, breaking the stereotypical narratives and creating beauty in a cinematic form. Moonlight, I don't know if you guys saw Moonlight, it's just so beautiful. I mean, when you're dealing with these hard characters and, you know, complex characters and dark, you know, dark story, but yet it's still so uplifting. And so just changing the emotional impact of some of, you know, African storytelling. I mean, I'm constantly shooting in Ethiopia because that's, you know, trying to connect with my heritage, but just really uplifting, nuanced images is really what I'm doing.
Just to kind of inform too, like, Moonlight is an example, I think, of kind of changing what you would think the form would be of that kind of story. Like, if I tell you I have a story about a kid growing up whose mom is addicted to crack, like, that looks a certain way. And Moonlight, like Moonlight's form, like, how they actually treat it visually, I mean, I think that's why I enjoy Atlanta, that's why I enjoy a lot of this kind of new wave of really dope black visuals and video, and film work that's been coming out. Because it seems like folks are playing with form, because those are some of the stories that we have, but you can tell them in so many different ways, and
Just, you know, the non-linear structures, or, playing with time and space and composition of color, just really doing crazy stuff with it, so.
I guess the beginning, which you were mentioning, just like how to address things, because I know like people are still telling things very well, but like the idea of what makes a black film, I mean, I think we all, either you're making a film, you just sort of deal with things, but even when we're making this film, like even that clip, I have to consider how, like, firstly, it's my family, so I'm inherently tied to it, but I'm thinking about like how these women want to come across on screen, black women want to come across on screen. Like the clip you saw was about a period of time in my life when my great grandmother was separated from her husband, but I didn't want to come off like, oh, she's like promiscuous or whatever it is. Like, how do you honor the nuance of life? Like, you know, you're separating, you still want love. Like, what is that? So I think that's the hard thing I think I deal with films sometimes, is that sometimes our images on screen are so polarizing for people because there haven't been a ton of images of ourselves. I just saw Kerry James Marshall's exhibition in New York, and he has this reference to the image bank, and that we have a deficit, like inherently, there's not enough images of us having a quotidian life, like a regular life. So we're just getting to that point. Like, you know, D.W. Griffith was like, which is what, just, you know, has laid out the film language, you know, for what we still use today, was KKK, and now people are superheroes. So like, that's like, what is that? Like, black people just got a man. Like, that's what, you know, so it's, I think that's the one thing, I think as a filmmaker, how I have to perceive things sometimes, whether or not I'm trying to just be in this artistic space where I can just ignore the world, but inherently the world comes in, so what do you do with it from that point? So.
Yes. So,
I guess I don't know how we're handling these, but if you have a question, I'll call on you and speak about it, please.
Can it be a statement and a question?
I really love questions, but if you have a statement, I would ask you to choose one or the other.
I would like to say
I really appreciate the diversity, like the segments that each of you presented, because it gave me an idea of what you do, who you are. And the fact is that you're your own uniqueness in terms of your experience, the things that you want to say at this point in time. Because those things evolve, they do different things. For me, that's beautiful, because I believe it's needed in terms of looking at things from a different way. And so I appreciate that. The other thing is, I'm leading up to a question, is the idea of if you were to ask Frederick Douglass that question, what is blackness? I wonder what that answer would be. At different times, different people, different stages, different experiences, the response would be totally different. Ask you that question 10 years from now, wow. But I think what it alludes to is the fact that you are expressing what you feel right now that you want to say. And those things will change and connect with people like me in a way that it helps me to gain more insight into what I think about the question. Last but not least, are any of you in the process of making a very big film that I can come see? Thank you.
How will we know about it? I'm sorry.
My website is my first and last name, LendlTellington.com. Whenever that time comes, it will be up there. And I hopefully have a mail list soon. But yeah, you can shoot me an email if you have any other questions.
I'll be looking for it.
Cool.
Thank you.
Same. This year is the year that we make the feature.
No. Always tiny, really small random projects that come out sporadically, they come out, but no large ones.
Yeah, I tend to stay in short format as well. I do have an installation coming up at University of Pennsylvania in April 22nd as part of a symposium. So I'm always creating installations in gallery settings. So.
Now, I have a question regarding Sosena. I have been to your studio maybe about 2 years ago, and I too am working on a trailer. However, your music's really tight. How does each of you have used music in your film trailers? How do you pick your music and make it so tight with the scenes? What's the secret, or is there a secret?
In the reel or just in general, how do we pick music for?
In general, because it's really, it really connects to the scenes and it makes you really.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, there's an emotion that music evokes, but there's a balance between how you know, it parallels with the actual narrative. So the music that I tend to pick in my films, they empower the visuals, if anything. They don't overshadow. So I think it's a delicate balance between you know, the emotion of the narrative and the emotion of the song.
I just take the word success. I think a lot of work that I've done prior was about musicians. A lot of it revolved around music. So I kind of had a cheat hole where, you know, I could use a musician's work. And a lot of times it would be a musician that I was even familiar with, where I just listened to a lot of their stuff to figure out, you know, this is the kind of feel that you're going to give. And so I tend to structure pieces rhythmically around music sometimes. For other types of cases, that's cheating, and sometimes I just listen to a bunch of stuff until I can find something that works. Or if the few times where I've really been balling, I'm able to like hand a piece and hand some references over to somebody that's able to make something really that works well for the piece and that's unique for the piece. But that's rare, you know, a really good chance.
Well, and also ambient sound and capturing a soundscape from the environment is really powerful. So whenever I film, I try to create soundscapes with that or find local musicians from a certain part of town that I'm filming in to kind of play part of the narrative. So.
This is more of like a follow-up question, but my question is about balance. making two kinds of work. One that focuses a lot on the issues that are important to the Black community, that are important in Black culture, but then also telling stories that aren't automatically labeled a Black story, but is a human story that just so happens to have Black people in it. And I think that both are very important, but I think that one is harder than the other because when a story has Black characters, it's automatically labeled a Black story. And it's like about Black issues. I've seen that a lot, even with, I think they said Best Man Holiday, when that came out, they were saying like, this is a Black movie about Black issues, when it was really a universal movie about friendship and marriage and sickness and universal themes. And you know, what if there were more stories like The Notebook or The Matrix that were had Black characters, and it could just be seen as a universal story? So I guess my question is about how you counter that, and also about the balance of when you want it to be, this is the focus, and when it's like, no, that's not it.
To avoid it in some ways because of just the culture of how we this country is built on race to a certain degree, and race or business or businesses have been built on race, including the film industry. So by someone saying this is a Black film, it does something for their sales. So I think there's power in that for us if we need to, you know, move forward and change some of these things. But I mean, at the end of the day, I think it's sort of just a repercussion of just our human existence in this country. I don't think we can necessarily dodge that. Unless you have some relationship with the studio or the people who are going to tell the story. Like, I think people struggle with this all the time, where things just get, you know, certain conversations happen during a certain time of year, or, you know, certain films are acknowledged after a really terrible award season last year, you know. So, like, beautiful work regardless, but it makes you question, you know, these things. So, I think that's just of the nature of being in this country or the world.
This is for Rashid. You mentioned that you were just beginning to explore how you can actually translate your films into an artistic approach, opposed to just doing it for, you know, the money. And I too kind of struggle with, you know, making films for the artistic approach. I do it because I'm kind of good at it, and I just want to know how you would start, you know, looking at it from a different angle, looking at like where you can pull inspiration from to actually create films just for the art.
I guess I'll tell you, this is a really nebulous answer, but I can tell you that's what I've been doing, and maybe it's been working, maybe not. Some of it is just like watching lots of stuff, like watching as many pieces to inspire me as I can, and also just watching a lot of talks. Like sometimes when I'm really feeling really fired up, I watch some of my talks on Highly Karmael, and then I'm just like, you must be the moment your mind! You know, that kind of, I mean, in one sense, as much as I can input, I feel like, will give me more perspective and helping me find my way. voice, you know? But the other part is you're gonna just make sure, you know, like, just trying to, as many things as I have kind of an interesting time in my life right now where I have a little bit of space to just try to make a bunch of stuff. So I'm just trying to make a bunch of stuff to see, you know, what skills I can bring over, how I can really sort of find what that voice is. And, you know, like, stuff that'll probably be, stuff that's varying from really terrible to kind of not terrible, you know what I mean? But I think some at least starting in some place of trying to make stuff that just flexes what you're curious about, which I shouldn't, and then just learning as much theory, as much, you know, as much art theory as you can stand, as much film theory as you can stand, as many, you know, read as much as you can, take as many, watch as many films as you can, just like kind of getting a habit of increasing that input and also trying to increase that output. And I think you kind of find your, hopefully, find that space somewhere along the way.
She's gonna make me walk.
Yeah. Thank you. First, I'd love to say, one, that it's great to see you guys, and no offense to the men, but it's definitely empowering and wonderful and beautiful to see Black female filmmakers up there. My question is, hopefully it doesn't sound too silly, I just binge-watched Project Greenlight, and one particular famous actor made the point that diversity on screen is important, but behind the screen it isn't. And I wanted to ask you, is it important to have representation behind the screen?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
I'm not doing it on this panel.
I guess not to keep talking. So have you seen that movie a while? So the shout out is the director who I'm weirdly obsessed with. He's a cinematographer. And like watching that film, to me, I can't describe it, and I don't know if I would have the same experience if I didn't know about the production before, but there's something to me Black as shit about the visuals. I don't have a better way to say it, but something really lush and sort of like referential to references that I sort of innately get in that film, even though it's Amy Adams and the ball that played Hawkeye in the Avengers. I forget his name, sorry. But like, I think, you know, I think we also have a lot to say about the show behind the camera, behind, you know, in our direction and in a lot of different places. I think everyone in those positions, you know, about
this. Can you repeat the name of the movie?
Arrival. It's Arrival. Arrival? It's on iTunes. You should buy it.
It's amazing.
I just want to interrupt because I said yes emphatically. I mean, I think we know that with the business side of filmmaking, that the reason that we don't see these works is because the people who make the decisions are not of color or women. And so we know that that has to change in order for the works to be made. But drawing upon what Rashid said, I mean, I have some practice as a costume designer, Sosena as an art director. Like, you've seen films and you've been upset at people's costumes when they're not right. If you saw The Wiz remake recently, it was so terrible. And then you find out the costume designer has no reference. Not that the person has to be of color, but there needs to be a diversity of who gets to do these jobs. So it's really important. It's important who edits it. It's important who makes the, you know, scores it. I mean, all of these things are making the film. It's not just the director or the actors. So, you know, down with that dignity.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's a sensitivity that you carry. You know, you're making these choices of camera angle and how you want something to be edited. And I think, you know, coming from that perspective and that knowing and understanding on a deeper level creates these nuances that make these films so, I don't know, spectacular. So, yeah.
A lot of filmmakers are geeky as hell. You need someone who's geeky, just as geeky as you in that space sometimes. Yeah. And I think that's important. So if someone's on the performing side, those relationships are just different sometimes, just inherently, as a human, Black, white, whoever. So it's like, I think you need someone who's like a fellow geek in that space, so.
I also think there's a lot of stuff that we do or that we bring to anything, any space, any area where we are, that we don't realize how much of ourselves or our like lived experiences we're bringing into that situation. So like with what everybody's been saying, you can have a film about a teenage girl edited by someone who's lived their life and identified as a man, and it's going to feel differently. No matter how good, not different, bad, or anything necessarily, but it's going to feel differently than if it's been edited by someone who diversity of my camera is so important because you need so many different, so many different lived experiences in order to make something that feels both very specific and also universal.
What I'm interested in is just like a brief thing, is just like even with Moonlight, which I think hopefully a lot of people have seen, you need to see, it actually has two film editors. One is a white male, one is a black female. So I think that does show through the film, but there's a reference.
And another point on Moonlight is that I think the colorist is a person of color, but the DP is a white man. And a lot of that film is really made in the color correction.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, so I have my own talk show, right? And one thing that we focus on is really breaking down stereotypes, right, within the black community, how people see black people and how they're portrayed on television, right? So I know a few of y'all said that with your art, you want to break down these stereotypes. So what does that look like, right? And could you maybe throw out some examples? And also, my second question is, if y'all could go back in time and give some advice to your 22-year-old self, what would you say?
I'm 22.
All right, 21 for you, 21.
I think the hard thing is that they will exist, and sometimes you just need to be in a space where you're just making work for you.
Yeah.
I think you need to make work for yourself at first, and quite honestly, F the, you know, the outside sort of, you know, connotations. You need that space for your own sanity. So I think that's the first step, and then, you know, when it gets into the world, I think you have to just walk at a certain point. You just can't take in the information. You have to respond to it.
I think in especially with certain friends of mine, we have lots of conversations because we're curious sometimes about the effectiveness of the white gaze, you know what I mean? Of just like, you know, like, I mean, I think we're all the point. I think you guys know that, you guys are familiar with the term white gaze, right?
No.
Yes, no. Basically how white people look at black is bigger than that, right? But in terms of, I think about it just in terms of how I make, there's this sort of like, you don't want to embarrass the race, you don't want to embarrass the culture. You know, our experience is so rich, you know? And I mean, not just to make it about, you know, making black work that deals with race or the work that deals with identity, but I think that's apparent in any work that gets made by anybody ever. But I think some of it starts with just how you ground yourself, how you see yourself, how you appreciate yourself, how you appreciate where you come from, and making stuff from that. Sometimes stuff seems stereotypical. That has more of a richness to it, right? Like, I think the things that are stereotypical are mad, they're very surface. You know what I mean? Like, you don't get a nuance from that character, you don't get anything, you know, additional from them, right? Like, they're kind of there to exist for whatever reason that character exists for, that scene or whatever, for that part. And I think, you know, if you can add richness and make those things real and honest, I feel like that's probably the best thing to bring back those stereotypes. That's the part.
Yeah, I would say watch Atlanta, quite honestly. Stereotypes, obviously, they're very surface. And I think Atlanta does such a great job of presenting a lot of scenarios that, if seen, or if they come out of a writer's room that was, you know, all white or wasn't as amazing as Atlanta's writer's room was, then they would just be stereotypes. It would be what we're used to seeing. But because it's coming out of a black writer's room, it's like you're able to see these things that are usually seen as stereotypes, but you're able to see the reality of the situation. And so I think Lendl said this, like, just tell it for you. That's what I try to do, and I think it works. I really think it works. Tell a story for you, or if not for you, then what I like to do sometimes is pretend that I'm writing to one specific person that I know who's not. I also find that works because you're not a stereotype. Like, you are a full human being, or every creator is a full human being. You're not a stereotype, so. If you're telling that story very specifically, like I said before, specific and universal, in your mind being specific and universal, then it's hard to be stereotypical. And then for your second question, I really don't know. I thought, yeah, 22.
you're kind of referring to, like some of the stuff right here, I think this is what I was talking about, talking to yourself. I think sometimes that baggage of separating what is expected of you as a Black artist versus what the norms are, or like norms are like either culturally or whatever within the entertainment industry, it's hard to pull those apart because they're so intertwined at some point, but you gotta develop what that is for yourself at a moment. And I think that's what I was telling my 22-year-old self, because I think at that moment in my life, I was pulled between like, you know, the crazy staff picks that were going to give me. I'm like, damn, why is my stuff not working like this? Like, I was feeling some type of way, but on the same note, having these stories, not necessarily, I should have been, I feel like at that time, I should have spent more time just honing in on what's my voice. I think that's what's most important as an artist to develop what is proprietary to you and your means of communicating. I think that's like the first step of anything, and just honing on that and just being honest with yourself about that. And that takes time.
In terms of stereotypes, yeah, I agree with everyone here. Emotion transcends any, you know, we all feel a certain way, we all feel love, we all feel fear, and so breaking through that in your characters. When I did the piece Mercado and documented the merchants, you know, they live a pretty modest life, and they don't have much, but they work really hard, and I think what makes the story so compelling is that they carry the sense of pride. And I show that, and so they're not, you know, these poor working merchants in Africa that are, you know, that they perceive to be, but I kind of break through who they are in the sense, well, they're entrepreneurs and they're their own bosses. And so I think it's how you see things. So the second part, I think, you know, I think I was kind of fearful when I was 22 in terms of how to hold this heavy camera, and you know, there weren't many people in my family that were artists, and so if I could go back, I would kind of transcend through that fear a bit and just, you know, shoot everything that I could. And there's so many moments that I wish I captured. Like, you know, you're always like, oh, I wish I had a camera. So I wish I was a bit more fearless.
We have time for two more questions.
I have one. We have our own talk show, and shout out to my friend Mary, she has it, so. But one thing I wanted to ask you was, so like on our talk show, like, we don't, like if I was on set, I wouldn't mind playing bad and bougie, you know what I mean? Like you could turn it up. So my question is, how, like, at least for me, how would you deal with like bringing your culture into other spaces, you know, of work? Because this, you know, it's a tough thing that I deal with, because I'm inherently Black. I do what I say, I mean, I'm going to listen to bad bougie, but if I'm on somewhere else, it's like, oh, I don't know if I should, or, so I'm like, how do you deal with that? And, you know, is there like any
own that shit.
Yeah.
I'm like a husky Black dude with a beard, so I can't really hide, you know? But I think, I don't know, man, our culture is beautiful. Bad bougie is an amazing song. Nobody should have denied that shit, right? Like, I think you know what's appropriate for what you're doing and stuff like that, but as much as you can own that, I think, you know, and take, you know, you take the punches that come with that too, you know what I mean? Like, I don't think that necessarily translates into something similar, but that's what represents you is as close as you can articulate it. I think you always try to go with that, unless somebody gives you a plot on me to do something else. So. I'm kidding about that.
Thank you. How y'all doing? All right. I heard some reference to it today. I just wanted to know, with all this discussion about what is a Black film, how important do you feel it is to engage or participate with the African or Caribbean film industries, markets that have majority Black populations?
Yeah, I think it's really important. I mean, there's stories that are not in the main light, you know, for a reason, and I think that's a whole, the culture is so rich, and, you know, I'm constantly traveling to South Africa and Ethiopia and Malawi to document these stories, and so I feel like we can cross that bridge, and I feel like it's really important, and that's a discussion that we should, I mean, yeah.
We've shown films from the region at BlackStar before, for sure. I mean, I don't think that's the most direct link that I can think of in my mind, but I think in general, Black diasporic stories should be should be cultivated in some way. I'm just waiting. I think what's going to be interesting in coming years, now that there is more of a conversation in the U.S., because the U.S. they're going to start seeing it trickle everywhere else, but about Black aesthetics and what it is to be a Black filmmaker, or you know, even an actor, and what that life is really like on a day to day. I think that is going to start permeating in different places. Like, I'm not sure what the actual industry is like in a place like in the Caribbean, because I'm sure, given the economic sort of strife that exists in some of these places, I'm sure the tools are limited. So it's going to be interesting to see what's going to happen now that technology is more democratized, and what's going to happen when stories start coming from out of those spaces, especially as you have platforms like Amazon and Netflix who are international now, and they're cultivating stories from everywhere. Any concept in India, any concept in Nigeria. So it's going to be interesting to see what stories start coming about more and more as a result of that.
Well, thank you so much. Could you join me in giving this panel? I just wanted to also say thank you to Sharon, Amira, Joan, and the staff of the Film Office for organizing this and pulling it together. And thank you to Leanne and Dee Dee and the faculty of the Film and Media Arts Department. And then also wanted to shout out to BlackStar staff member Katsi, who's not here, for pulling together all the panelists' info. And then also wanted to just plug a little bit. If you have not heard of BlackStar or been to the festival, please follow us on all social media platforms at BlackStar Fest. Our website is blackstarfest.org. Submissions are open for this year's festival. They close August 23rd. There's a youth component, and that submissions process closes April 30th. Also, I also work at the ICA, and we have an open video call. I don't know the deadline, so look that up if you're interested. Oh, thanks. And then also, look for, on July 13th, there'll be an exhibit at Drexel's Pearlstein Gallery, featuring a number of artists, including Sosena. So, thank you all.